My background is with the Ethereum Foundation. I have been part of the Ethereum Foundation since 2015 to 2018, and I have built one of the first user interfaces for Ethereum, including the Mist browser and the Web3.js library that's commonly used within the Ethereum and the blockchain space. And I kind of had the luck to be exactly in the middle between developers and users and the core developers in Ethereum. And I had the chance to define a lot of the early ways of how we are operating and interacting with Ethereum. What I'm presenting today is actually an evolution and an upgrade on this user experience and on this developer experience that we are having today. So I will be talking about a new standard for blockchain and NFTs. This is a standard that's based on ERC-725. That is a standard I proposed around 2017. It will be a very technical talk where I'm showing off what's possible and how it works, and how you can actually use it for yourself and why it's important. So using blockchain is hard. It's especially hard because everything in blockchain is based on keys. A blockchain actually only understands keys. In the normal web, we are using email and passwords, and the server stores this and compares that you're typing in the right thing. Blockchains only understand signed messages and signed transactions. And that's actually really, really safe, right? Because the only person who really needs to know the secret is the person who holds the key. The problem with this is it creates a very complicated user experience. You go to a wallet application, you start out, you just want to check it out, and then you have to like remember a seed phrase, type in seed phrases and all of these complicated things. And the number one question that you're getting asked is, hey, can you write this down on paper? Like, as if everybody would have papers with them while, you know, opening an app. And that's the kind of user experience that like kills it upfront, right? And the problem of why do you have to do this complicated thing is because this key stores all your assets. So all your important stuff sits on these keys. So what happens if you lose the key? All your assets are gone. So you have to make sure, even if you don't care in the beginning, that that key is safe. Blockchain accounts to the rescue, and that's where ERC-725 is all about, and that's the thing that will change the user experience in the so-called Web3 world. There was this idea from Vitalik a few years back about account abstraction, and the idea about account abstraction is that the blockchain itself, Ethereum itself, does not decide anymore what is a valid signature, but you have like a smart contract that can determine what is a valid signature. It's kind of like, instead of being the key who's important, you have like an account. There's a lot of problems with that because you now have to figure out how you make transactions without gas and all of this. And this kind of evolved, and actually we have a very recent proposal from September where this is becoming a thing in the future. But it doesn't solve a few problems that we're still having, which I think ERC-725 is solving. ERC-725 is a standard that I proposed in October 2017, and it's the idea to have a smart contract that is your account that can be controlled by one or multiple keys. Those are replaceable, and that's a smart contract that can hold all kind of information, and it's so flexible that we don't even need to define all the things that it could be doing in the future. And that was kind of a popular idea at the time. It was all about identity and so on. And there was this ERC-725 alliance that was created around that by other people. And a lot of people signed up and said, hey, you know, we want to use this. This sounds cool and so on. Since then, a lot of thinking went into this. And a few people tried around and built some interfaces and so on. But it never really took off yet because the whole idea was not fully finalized yet. So I'm working on a project called Luxo, which is a blockchain built on the Ethereum stack. So it's using the Ethereum protocol, not the Ethereum network. It will be a blockchain for actually a new kind of user, a user who does not want to know about keys and does not understand technology to the degree that we require today when using blockchain. It's the ordinary gamer, or it's the ordinary social media person that wants to do something with blockchain, that wants to hold these new kind of assets, but it just doesn't understand what easy DSA mean or like signatures. It's also a blockchain for a new type of assets where not only these assets have to be more flexible than they are with the standards we have in Ethereum, but also where your account and your public profile is essential to all of these things, be it on the side of the issuer or be it on the side of the owner, right? The one who is buying it and transferring it. So we have a few problems with accounts as keys. And one of them is obviously we can give them names. In Ethereum, we have ENS. The Ethereum name system allows us to like have a nice little like findura.eth or frozman.eth or whatever we want, or rig.eth linked to our key. The problem is we cannot easily attach information to this key like a JSON file that could hold a additional information like linking images or linking my websites and so on. That's what the smart contract accounts can solve. And one of the things we're working on at Luxo is what we call universal public profiles. And wouldn't it be cool if I could have a blockchain-based account that looks like a Web2 account that actually has images and all kind of information attached to it like we are used to in the Web 2.0. This is actually the future of blockchain interaction. This is something which we would think is the normal, but it's still not there yet because we have to agree on standards. And that's the point of ERC 725. So ERC 725 in its essence is a very simple standard, an agreement that says that you have an account that is able to execute. So that's the last function here. The execute function is literally the one who can talk to any other smart contract, do everything a key can do as well. It can like hold assets, it can transfer assets, it can execute a DeFi protocol, it can talk to all kind of other smart contracts in any shape or form. But it also can hold information, and that's what the ERC-725Y or this set data, get data we see here is about. It's basically the ability to have a key value store attached to your account. And because it's a very generic key value store, which has a simple byte 32 to bytes mapping, whatever we are attaching to this account does not need to be defined yet. This is something that can be defined in the future. And this is something that we can, and we already came up with to make these profiles more interesting and give them additional information. So let me explain in very simple terms of how ERC-725 works. On the one hand, you have your smart contract that represents your profile, let's say in this case. It is controlled by one address, and that one address could be a simple key, but the one address could also be a key that you can easily replace, right? You could even send a key via email because it's something you can change later, right? It does not need to be super secure initially because you have nothing on your account anyway. But it can also be another smart contract that could be, for example, a key manager that can allow you to add multiple keys as a controller and give even those keys different permissions. That means one of the keys might be the one who can change and add keys and do more complex functions on your own profile, like adding new data and removing data. But it could also be a key that is simply allowed to talk through your profile, but only talk to a specific smart contract or call a specific function on another smart contract. This kind of level of permission granularity allows us to actually interact with dApps, let them talk and interact through our profile without that we really have to fear that they steal our money or do some kind of scammy things, because we can really restrict that. Also, having a key manager like this or having a smart contract controlling your account allows you to have a transaction relay service, meaning somebody can send a transaction for you, paying for all the gas. So you don't need to have the native token of that blockchain. In our case, it's the Lux token, or on Ethereum would be Ether, to interact with your account, because you can simply use that relay service and your key manager can verify if that message was really signed by you and if it's really you asking to do this. On the other hand, and that's the cool thing, is you can attach all kinds of information. And attaching all kind of information means that you can attach information like images, like a profile image, like a self-chosen username, or all kind of other reputation system. Things that we don't even need to know right now or need to define or have defined yet what you want to attach to those items and to your profiles. It's a very flexible system, and that's what we call ERC-725Y, like why, you know. Why? You get the joke. And actually, it allows us to do a lot of things with those kind of profiles even in the future. You know, out comes something that can look like this, you know, but it's a fully smart contract based account system that can hold assets, that can interact with blockchain items and other protocols the same way like every normal account does, but it just looks a lot better and it can have a lot more transparency to it. So coming back to the ERC-725 YNX standard, let's take a look how this kind of flow works if you want to interact with your profile, or if you want to interact with other smart contracts using your profile. The way it works is that you actually would talk through your key manager, right? If you want to have a more, you know, complex profile, you want to have a key manager contract. The beauty is that is something that can be changed and altered over time. So we can have all kind of new permission systems and key managers we can add in the future, and we are not forced to, like, you know, live with this one system we deployed 2 years ago forever. What has to stay is your ERC-725 contract, because it's a very minimal thing and it's kind of like your root profile identity. It has its own address, it's identifiable, and it holds all this information and can hold all of these assets. So the flow would basically be, in simple terms, I would talk to my key manager, which talks to my 725 contract, which then talks to any other smart contract. If I have a relay service, I would talk to the relay service, send him a signed message, he talks to my key manager, and then he talks to my 725 contract and talks to the other smart contracts. This can be an anonymous account, so I can attach no information. It looks just like a key on the blockchain. Or it can be a public account because I can link photos or texts or whatever other references to it. Those are obviously stored not on the blockchain, they will be stored in JSON files and linked, you know, in another form. But because I can attach information, I can make it a verifiable account. You know, I could have even a KYC. I can make it a lot more pretty, like we just saw. But the same standard, the 725 standard, can also be used for NFTs, and that's why we call it NFT 2.0, or how we internally call digital certificates. So basically, attaching a 725Y, and that's using only the substandard, not the execute function, but only the key value store, and linking this to another common standard like 721 or ERC20 or 777, I can actually create an NFT that can have, it could be a type of item, that can have, you know, 100 units that can be bought or transferred or owned. And because I have this ability to attach information to it, I can create an NFT that's far more sophisticated and far more interesting than what we have today, right? We can have multiple creators, for example. That's especially interesting for digital fashion, which is created by brands and sometimes multiple designers. And we can attach all kinds of file formats. We can attach a reputation system. So many of those things you could easily do by simply having a JSON file linked to it. But some of those information you want to have in the smart contract because you want other smart contracts to be able to automatically verify things. For example, maybe you want to go, if you receive an NFT, you want to automatically check who created it and then check on the creator if a certain information is present. Or you may want to check a reputation system that's linked from that and then go to that smart contract and read some information about the status or the rating of the item. I can even attach a full signature, readable and verifiable from another smart contract. So all of the other things is quite easy attaching a JSON, but when it's about automatic verification through other smart contracts, you do need that stuff in the smart contract as well. And having this flexibility, which ERC-725Y gives, where you can create items that can have different places to live, right? It could be something that you take into your VR chat environment, into Sansar, into any other game, but it's also something that could have a life in social media and wherever else. And that brings me to how does this technically work, right? I mean, we already saw a few of those things, but obviously as a developer, you don't want to have all of this complicated under the hood storing, encoding and decoding. And that's what the ERC-725 JS library does for you, and that's why the ERC-725Y schema exists. Because now we have a key value store, and this key value store can literally store anything, any kind of bytes and any kind of key, which is 32 bytes. We need to define what these keys are and what is this content. And we also need to define how this content is decoded and how it's interpreted. And that's what this ERC-725 why schema is, and you can check that out under this link in the LSP repository under LSP2. So LSP is Luxor Standards Proposal, where we describe exactly what kind of keys exist, how you decode them, and what you can store. That makes our life a lot easier, defining a lot more standards on top of ES 725Y. One of these here in this example is a universal profile. So that's, for example, the one you saw in the pictures before. So we define first, we define like that there's a standard, it's a ES75Y account, so another smart contract can easily check, is it an account or do I'm dealing with something else? And it has a profile linked to it, which in this case is a JSON URL. That's a specific format that allows you to download a JSON file and verify that the JSON file is actually the one you wanted to have. And the LSP1 universal receiver delegate, that's something I'm not talking in this video because it's a bit too, we'll get too deep. And LSP3 issued assets, for example, could be all kinds of NFTs that you're creating if you're a creator yourself. So all of this looks complicated, but the beauty is, you know, if you have libraries like user725.js, it's just like as simple as like adding the schema to your library. If you add this schema to your library and you give it the address of the contract you want to talk to, right, be it an NFT or be it a profile or be it whatever else people come up with in the future, and you give it a provider, that could be the Web3 provider, could be the Ethereum provider, that could be even a GraphQL, you can easily read this data and all the decoding is done for you automatically because it understands the ES75Y schema. So for example, I could simply say get data LSP3 profile, and in the low version, like when it's not fetching the assets directly, I would actually get the URL, the hash, and the hash function. I could decide to download it. I can compare the hashes. I know what I got is correct. Or I can actually use the fancy version, which is fetch data, which then also already downloads the JSON file for you, does all the checks, compares the hashes, and makes sure that what you got back is correct, and returns you the JSON file. So that's the pretty easy way. So that allows us to retrieve information from a smart contract that can be holding all kinds of complex information, like in this case, the description of a profile, while simply calling one line of code. But I can also do the same thing for assets. You know, I can store an image, or I could store a GLB 3D file, and I could easily retrieve it and automatically check that what I'm retrieving is unaltered. It's the same content that was uploaded by the creator. I mean, there's a lot more to it, and that's already the very short introduction, and the documentation will show you more what you can do. But having these kind of libraries and having these standards allows us to actually enhance smart contracts, be it a profile or be it simply information about an audit that the smart contract went through. That we can now automatically retrieve, we can have interfaces reading that automatically, and we can have all kind of extra smart contract checks and balances and interactions that are yet to be defined. And there's a lot coming that we are doing on Luxor, which will make interacting with smart contracts fun again. Hopefully a lot more fun for the normal user who shouldn't be drowned in like complicated tech jargon and lengthy onboarding processes. My goal for all of this space, having defined the early ways of how to do it, to actually move it to its next level, to make it fun to interact with the Web3. With Luxor and our own blockchain, we can actually really nicely show that, because we can like create these profiles and make them the default from the beginning and create a new economy based not on keys, but on smart contract based accounts. So I hope you liked this presentation. All the links are here. So you have the ES75JS library, you have the original 725 document describing the standard, and the LSPs. We will release a lot more standards under the LSP repository. Obviously, one is the ES75Y JSON schema, explaining you what kind of keys you can store and how you would decode them. That's what the ES725JS does automatically for you. And obviously interesting is the LSP3 profile that we are using. And there's a few more coming, and there's a lot more space to invent on top of just the ES75 alone. So looking forward to the future. Thanks for watching this. I hope you will enjoy that, trying that out. Let us know what you think. Thank you.